It's 2010, October the 9th, Indiana game.
My grandson, he was there. We went together. He's been my best buddy since he was born.
I wasn't aware of anything, didn't know anything, what happened, what took place.
It was just a normal day for us, excited about the game. We arrived early, so we go to this call session at St. John's Arena. We started looking at some team photos. I thought he was just going to get a closer look, and within a split second, he was actually passing out. They had crews within probably a minute or two inside St. John's that were right outside, and they were able to do CPR within minutes on him.
In Tommy's situation, the EMS was able to recognize that he was in the midst of a heart attack and brought him directly to the cardiac catheterization lab, where we were able to open up his artery and restore the blood flow to his heart.
The time that we want their vessel open is 90 minutes. We routinely are under 60 minutes in our community because of early recognition of our crews, training on what they're supposed to be seeing, and transmitting that into the hospital.
The team taking care of Tommy knew exactly what steps to take to save his life because of the results of clinical research. This started with the EMS team. We would not know what to do if it weren't for the results of these clinical trials.
Research has shown that induced hypothermia in cardiac arrest patients has improved outcomes, increased survival. And how that works is by reducing the oxygen demand of the brain. To start that cooling process, we can reduce the amount of damage done as a result of cardiac arrest, things like free radical production, amino acid production, and calcium shift in the cells due to the damage that was caused by the heart not beating normally.
By cooling someone after they've had an out-of-hospital arrest, we're able to protect the brain. It's critical for the early recognition, early activation of the emergency medical services so that they can initiate cooling protocols if necessary, and use other medications that can help preserve the heart function.
We would not know how to use hypothermia to save people's lives as we did in Tommy's situation unless we had conducted the clinical research to gain the important information.
The day I woke up and I saw the face of my wife.
It was after they had taken him off the ventilator. And I was sitting there, I was thinking, oh my God, he's not gonna wake up. And they were screaming at him. So I walked over and I said, Tommy, wake up, you gotta go to work. And he just went like that and looked at me.
As in Tommy's case, he was able to recover completely, neurologically intact, able to recognize his family and go back to doing all of his activities of daily living, and go back to a normal, functional life.
The first thing that I got to celebrate when I got home was the birth of my great-granddaughter.
There's a few people that you want there to experience that with you. And he's definitely one person that I wanted to be present at that time of having my first child. To know that the doctors were able to give that to us was special to me.
That's something you can't talk about enough. So that's precious. To have the equipment, to have the techniques, the drugs, all these things came into play in my survival.
Research on defibrillation, chest compression, the cooling protocols, all contributed to saving his life.
People volunteering their time to go and allow these surgeons and doctors and everybody, the ambulance crews, everybody to have the procedure down to a certain technique.
Participation in research at a basic translational clinical level saves lives.